Hi, this is Melissa for Boxing News TV, and I've managed to catch up with Richard Riakporhe fighting this week in Peterborough. But I don't want to talk about boxing today. I want to talk about you as a person, your journey, where you've come from. So Enhancing Mind is what you've been working under at the moment. You've been going into schools and prisons and talking about your life experience. What was childhood and growing up like for Richard Riakporhe?
Childhood was really, really rough. You know, it's growing up on a big council estate. You can imagine what the people were getting up to make money, to kind of acquire some power or any of some sort, to acquire different materialistic things, cars, clothes. Everybody had to get up to something, and nothing was legal. Nothing was legal. Also, just that street credibility. You needed street credibility to walk around, like, and not have no problems. Because if you came out with anything flashy, like, I remember there was a time where everybody used to rock these Averix jackets. Do you remember them? Like, you used to see loads of guys with Averix jackets, but stopping around here because they used to rob them. If you had your jacket on, they'll take it from you. If you had your shoes on, they'll take it from you if they were fresh, and they'll sell it or wear it. So it was tough back then. You know, we had to kind of build a name for ourselves so we can be protected. We didn't have older brothers or cousins to kind of protect us and say, listen, that's my little cousin, leave him alone. Because we were the first generations coming up, us Africans, Nigerians, those Jamaicans, they were there, of course, before us. But it was like we had to build ourselves. We had to be crazy, like, you know what I'm saying, literally. We had to be crazy to obviously get our street credibility up, where people respect us and be like, listen, don't even try anything with him because you'll be in trouble.
And what age were you exposed to all this?
Oh, this is from young, man. Let's say 10, 11. I remember my first fight on the street. One guy, my little brother, was going to school, and they tried to pick on my little brother. They tried to rob him and search him. And I found out who these guys were. My brother was 11, I was 12. And I found out who these guys were. Saw them at a fun fair. Started going back to back. The guy said he wanted to have a fight with me. And I said, okay, I'll have a fight with him. But he had his knife on him. So I thought, I have to be careful. Like, I need somebody to, like, at least take the knife from him so I don't get stabbed. And obviously, I don't get rushed as well from other people. So I just need somebody to just kind of guide it. But I had a fight with him in the end. But he became my best friend later on down the years. But he was hanging. He had a knife at 12. Like, flick out shank. Like, they meant business. Now. It was crazy back then. It's crazy.
And when you were 15, you were unfortunately stabbed at a party. Tell me a little bit about how that happened and how it's impacted your current mindset.
Yeah, so, like, I went to a party outside, just talking to a few of my friends, and we're just kind of planning our next move, because back then we used to go from party to party to party. So we hit like 3 parties in one night. And then one guy came outside and started asking everybody for their phones. We didn't know. We were puzzled, like, what are you talking about? And anybody that hesitated, he would just stab them. So he ended up stabbing 3 of us. And I was the one with the most severe stab wound. So.
And you were taken to hospital. And when did you really know the full severity of what happened?
About 7 years later. Because I was so young. I was 15 years old. I didn't understand, how complex the stabbing was. And just the seriousness of it, to be honest. And it was just more of an experience for me. I had a lot of attention on me. People cared for me. That showed how much people cared for me, kind of thing. And I got a little name, like, because to get stabbed and survive, it's like, you know, wow, you must be a soldier. So, yeah, but it's only till now that I understand how serious it was. I nearly died.
And I think all of these things we mentioned before, they kind of make you or break you. You know, you can choose to take the wrong path in life. You can get caught up in gang culture. You know, a lot of kids on the street these days, they don't actually know what they're doing. They're just easily influenced.
Yeah. A lot of these, obviously, it's down to a lot of things. Environment, of course, that's one thing. Boredom. I didn't have a lot of things to do back then. I wasn't directed in the right path, whereas to do something constructive, whether it's play football or stay in a team or do a type of sport or do some type of activity which you can compete with or lead to some type of greater cause, and it was just that kind of led me on this pathway. And that's how it is now. Like, the kids these days, they don't have nothing to look forward to. They wake up with no plan. It's just like they just take the days day by day, how it goes. And that's, it's really dangerous, because you can get yourself in any mix up. You hang around with the wrong people as well, that will influence your pathway as well. And your,
and you mentioned before that, you know, you go into prisons now and do talks, and you see some of your friends on the other side, and you walk in there and people are listening to you. You're making a difference and having an impact to these people's lives. How does that make you feel?
Yes, yeah, it's humbling. It's humbling. I've never been a boastful type of individual. I'm just pretty quiet, laid back, collected. But, you know, to see the effect that it has on people that I used to hang around with day in and day out, and them to now, today, look up to me and say that I'm their inspiration, is humbling. And it makes me want to do more. It makes me want to be more successful. You know, just achieve more, really.
Would you say boxing saved your life?
Yeah, for sure. Because there was a time, it was like I was at the crossroads. I knew that on this, if I continue on this path, I'm going to either end up dead or in jail. I knew it was either one of the two. A lot of people like to feel like I'm going to be the lucky one to make all the millions like Pablo, but I'm not going to die like Pablo or Scarface. I'm not going to sniff drugs like Scarface, take drugs like Scarface. So it's like, it's that delusion that we kind of ran with. But everything that we were doing was leading us to the abyss. So it's like, it's crazy. So what I realized is that I need to do something else. I had to do something else. And boxing just fitted in perfect with my life, because I always loved boxing. I loved the respect that it demanded, the courage that, you know, it was like the modern day gladiators, isn't it? So it's like, you know, you have to respect it. Like, these boxers train hard, they discipline themselves, dedicate themselves completely to the sport. And I just thought, you know what, let me just do this, because this might kind of fit in with what I represent and what I thought of myself back then. And before I knew it, I was competing. I didn't have time to hang around on the streets no more, chill on the blocks with the mandem, because I had a fight on Saturday. I had to rest. So that boredom element was subtracted out of the equation, and I stopped getting myself in a lot of trouble, as I did prior to that.
Did you manage to influence any of your other friends into getting away from that kind of gang life and not getting into trouble? Did anyone else think, do you know what, I've seen Richard do it, and, you know, I'm going to get in the gym, or I'm going to do something constructive?
Yeah, I received messages from hundreds of people that I don't even talk about, I don't mention their names, but they say that, like, because of me, they've changed their lives, they've gone on to do this, they've, like, you know, they're just completely inspired by my story, and because of you, I do this now, or I change this, and it's humbling, it just makes me want to strive for more and achieve more, because with me achieving more, you know, I have more power to affect communities and change communities for the better.
You've got a little boy who's 9, and we just mentioned before, you know, there's some kids as young as 9, 10, 11, 12 that carry knives around on them. You know, how refreshing is it to know that you can make a difference to your son's life by inflicting the correct morals and telling him that there is other options out there?
Yeah, that's very important, you know, because we don't want our kids to get involved in the same type of lifestyle. You know, that's why we work so hard, and that's my main motivation. You know, like, I can never have him suffer the way I suffered growing up. It's crazy, and it's touching, really. You know, the things that I went through, I could never let him go through that. I'll do everything in my power to make sure that he doesn't have that type of lifestyle that I had growing up. Kids shouldn't have that. Kids shouldn't see the things that I've seen, you know.
And will you be open and honest with him about your childhood and your upbringing? Will you sit down and have conversation with him and be straight?
Yeah, of course. Like, I put all of this on YouTube, on all over these big platforms. You know, you could just type in my name in on Google and you'll see tons of stories. Like, he searches himself and reads and knows all about everything that I've been through. So it's you can't hide it, man, on the World Wide Web.
Not these days, anyway. You mentioned you've been to jail. What did you do time in jail for?
You know what? I didn't get convicted of the crime, but I went in there for GBH of intent. It was a long story, but we were innocent. We were innocent. Seriously. Because a lot of people, they say that, but it was true. Like, there was a guy, because of our street credibility, he sold us a car on finance. The car was on finance, but he pretended like he bought it completely paid. It was completely paid for, sold it. And we found out it was on finance because I got stopped in it and they took the car. And that's when we were looking for him. We're like, listen, we want our money back. And something happened around the area and he picked us all out in ID parade. And that's all you need to do. Pick somebody in ID parade and you go to jail. That simple, and remand. It was in remand and the case got thrown out after 2 months. So it was just like a holiday, if you would. It was the experience. I never did no time in jail like that. And we came out and I thought, this is not the place for me. That place is, it's like, it's not really that bad. Like if you compare it to jails in obviously South America, exactly. South America, Africa, it's fairly all right, you know, but it breaks you down mentally. That's what people don't understand, breaks you down mentally. And, you know, to the point where even when you come out, when you release, people can tell by your behavior, the way you act, the things that you're interested in, it affects you so much. Like, it's hell. That's what they call it, hell.
When you first went into a boxing gym, how long before you thought, I could really do this for a career and this is what I want to do for the rest of my life?
Straight away. After the first year. No, not even a year. Like, let's just say 6 months. I said to my coach, yep, I want to do this. I had a little bit of success and a few fights and I thought, you know what, I want to do this forever. And he said to me, Richard, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Do something else on the side. I thought, what? Do something else on the side? What? You don't believe in my ability to be successful in boxing? I took it really offensively. But it's only till now I understand what he said, what he meant. Because these things don't last forever. It's only for a period of time. And once it's done, what's next? What are you going to do next? Fortunately for me, I went to uni. I got a degree in marketing and advertising. So, you know, I was already patented. Yeah, I was already, you know, straight kind of thing. A lot of boxers they're not educated at all. And it's crazy because I remember watching, you know, all these guys on a GB circuit and all these, you know, competing at the Commonwealth Games and the Olympics. And I was so envious. I wanted to be there so badly. But I was studying. And my path was different, but 10 years later, I'm here with them and I'm actually in a better position than them. So it's like me going through that, it didn't take nothing away from me. It's mad. It actually paid off even more. It paid more dividends because I'm fresher at the same time. I haven't had too many fights, even as an amateur. So, and I'm still competing at this level and I've achieved quite a bit for obviously my experience. So it's a blessing. It's a blessing. I believe it's destiny, man.
They say boxing's a business and that you are a brand in yourself. So, you know, it's only going to help you outside of the ring to build yourself as an endorsement as such. Because when boxing ends for you, you're going to leave a legacy behind for your children. And it's nice to know that it's not just going to be however many knockouts and wins. It's going to be, you know, that you changed people's lives, that you went into prisons and schools and you made a difference. You've got a foundation, hopefully, which you've mentioned that you want to set up, and that there's stuff put in place for your children. How important is it to set yourself up for life after boxing?
Listen, it's so important. It's so important. And a lot of trainers and managers, they don't talk about these things to the fighters. It's like they don't really care. They just care about the money. They care about seeing the money and sticking them in there with whoever so they can just see something from it. And it's pretty sad. That's why a lot of these guys are retiring and they're suffering from all different type of issues mentally, because it's like once it's done, they're not doing nothing. It's like there's no motivation to continue living. It's like with boxing, it's like we're training every single day. We're eating right, sleeping right. But what happens when you can't do that no more? It's like, what next? Go to the gym and lift weights. No, people don't respect that, especially fighters. People don't respect that. And not all fighters, actually, but It's like they would rather do something a bit more constructive, more meaningful. That's why it's very important to set yourself and make a plan about what you want to do afterwards. Obviously, hopefully that your health is intact, because obviously everybody knows how dangerous boxing is. So yeah, and just do something a bit more productive.
Have your family always been supportive of you and what you do?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, my family, they were a bit skeptical in the beginning, because everybody wants to box, innit? Everybody wants to box. Everybody wants to jump in the ring, and experience the limelight. But it's all good. You can look good on the pad. You can look good in the gym. But it's only till like you get clocked on the chin, or you go through certain things. That's when you wake up and okay, this is boxing. I don't know if this is for me, or just experience the type of sacrifice and the dedication that you have to do to compete at a high level, and then realize, you know what, this is not for me. That's why they come to you. I've seen many, many, many people come and go from the gyms, like just training in the gym, let alone fighting. Like they'll come in the gym 3 months, disappear, 6 months, disappear. They'll come back again 6 months later. They'll be like, oh, I shouldn't have took a break. You can't take breaks in boxing. Yeah.
What percentage of boxing do you think is mentality?
About 80%, 90%. Because for me to go and turn on the light, I have to think about it first, isn't it? For me to stand up, I have to think about standing up first. It's the mind that controls the body. You have to, it all works together, you know. So, and plus, if you don't believe in yourself as an athlete, how can you achieve great things? It's like doubt. Once that creeps in, they say you can lose before you enter the ring. Like, a lot of people won't understand that concept. But if you doubt yourself so much, it's like you manifest it into reality, because you just don't go for it. You just feel like, oh, I don't think I can win.
And moving forward with the foundation, what are your visions for this foundation? You know, what impact you want to have? I'm hoping not just on the UK, but the world, you know, your heritage, and going back to where your family's from, and showing people that there's other things they can do with their life. And you're a living example of that.
Yeah, so I want to have my foundation and programs run all around the world. Starting off with the UK, I get a lot of bookings in the UK, as I told you before. We started this interview, loads of bookings in the UK, in towns I've never ever heard of before in my life, prisons, and I feel something big coming along. Like I said, I've said in a few interviews before this, like this is not about me. This is bigger than me. This is about what we could do to help our community, to help our country. There's a lot of things going on, and we need more people like me. And I ain't putting everything on me, but listen, I didn't have to come out here and tell my story and things that happened to me. I could have just kept quiet, like most athletes do, and just carry on grinding and working hard and still get to where I want to get to. But I decided, you know what, let me use my platform to help other people, because that's what people are going to remember in the end. Muhammad Ali, a lot of people will debate and say that he wasn't the best, greatest, technically, in the whole of boxing or boxers, but it's about what he stood for outside the ring, as obviously being an activist himself, standing up for what he believed in, and that's why they consider him the greatest boxer alive, and that's what I do, because he didn't care what anybody thought about him. He just went out there and said, "Listen, this is not right. This is right." And you always get respect for that, and that's what I believe in. So,
and if you could give some advice to the current generation now that want to get into sport, or want to be a painter, or want to work in TV, what would be your main piece of advice to give to the youth of today?
Yeah, what I tell kids or students when I go into the schools to talk, I always say, find something that you love to do, something that you could do without being paid for it. Because a lot of people like to get into a field where they know the money is large, vast, so they're going to make money and they're going to be happy. But it don't work like that. You could do something for a lot of money and still not be happy. So it's all about being happy in life, because you'll be more productive and you'll get more out of life. So I tell them, you can choose a field like football, for instance, but you don't have to be a footballer. Not everybody has that type of athletic build or whatever, but you can still do something else in football. You can be a football manager, you could be a lawyer, you know, your contractor. You know, there's so many different things you could do in the field, but it's first about finding this field that you love and then doing research in the field. And then after that, things will follow. Once you find out what you want to do, like money and everything else will follow. But I always tell them it's about definiteness of purpose. So they need to find out what they want to do, like now, like today. Because as time goes on, they waste time. And when you're still trying to find your way, you can still slip on and go on the wrong path. But when you know what you want to do in life, definiteness of purpose, you just go straight, you become like successful faster. That's what I would say to you.
Thank you very much for your time. I'm definitely, definitely going to come down and see one of your talks. You'll have to come. Could you come to Manchester?
Yeah, you should. And put one of them accents as well.
Let's not start on the accent. This is meant to be a serious interview, Richard. Just touching on something a little bit more lighthearted now. Your fight on Saturday night. How's your preparation gone?
I haven't prepared properly. I only did a little bit of sparring and a little bit of cardio, but I still believe I'm going to win, you know, because that's what it's about. It's about what you believe in. I believe I'm going to win. I'm going to get the W, keep it moving.
Thank you very much. Thank you.